Hello and a very warm welcome to episode 71 of the Sussex by the Sea podcast, a podcast that now covers local football in this great town of ours, as well as keeping up with all the frills and spills, highs and lows of my team, Hastings United. On today's show, we have week two of Hastings Report with co-host and ESFL veteran Leon Pettit. We then have an interview with JOHN CAREY, Hollington manager, on his time at Sidley, how he thinks the Lions will get on this season, and the exciting future ahead at the Gibbons. Then we move on to the SBTS fan roundtable, where me and the boys round up week one of the U's first week back in the Prem. Enjoy, grassroots football fans. And here is the SBTS shout outs. And this one, Emma Hopkins has wrote into us. It was just to tell all us U's fans that there's a new raffle being run by the club. They're going to be there week in, week out, by the ramp as you go into the pilot bar. All sorts of prizes, from bottles of drink to vouchers that can be used at the club shop. It's £1 a pop, and they're thinking of doing a kids' raffle for 50p a ticket so that everyone can get involved. All money that's going in is going to come straight back out to you, the fans. So please, get yourself a ticket. Also, I want to shout out Tim Reeves. Tim, he always runs an annual fundraiser in the memory of Barry Gerd. This was the 10th year. This year's one was at Lingfield Racecourse. Now, obviously, all the money was going towards St. Michael's Hospice. Tim and all the people involved with him managed to raise over £10,000. Brilliant stuff, Tim. And to all those that gave money to such a worthy cause.
When I was younger than before, I never saw the truth hanging from the door. But now I'm all in, see it face to face.
To Hastings Report. Right, it gives me great pleasure to have the returning Leon Pettit, ESL, I love saying it, but he's an ESFL veteran, regular on this podcast. He's the co-host for this segment, which is we're rounding up the SCFL, MSFL and ESFL, the Hastings Report. This is week two. Just quickly, I see you're still alive because I know you played on Saturday in this heat. How are you, first of all, Leon?
Yeah, I'm fine. Yeah, no, I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk about that later because we know that there's been visits to hospitals because of possibly you or, I don't know, members of your team. Hopefully There's no charges. Anyway, first of all, for our SCFL sides, Bexhill travelled to Surrey and smashed Alford 3-0. We saw someone me and you have spoken to on the phone, Leon, Mr. Dan Hull, who bagged a brace, and Samuel Scott, who made it free, a comfortable visit there. Your thoughts on the game? Seemed like a comfortable outing for Bexhill United.
Yeah, see, that Dan Hull's a very good signing.
Yeah,
brilliant for Bexhill signing. At that level, I'm sure he'll be a very effective player for him. I'm sure that'll be the first of many goals he'll get.
Well, we must try and get him on. I'm going to attempt to get him on. Obviously, the last time we spoke to him was when his brother rang him up.
I think I was the instigator in that as well. So I better apologise to him, and I.
Yeah, well, there's so many apologies you got to give. Obviously, after that impressive result, Leon, Bexhill are going to travel down, going over to Hill Park to play Saltbeam. That's going to be tomorrow night because we're recording on the Monday, so it's Tuesday night kickoff. I mean, I know they are playing at Saltbeam, and we know that Saltbeam's record last season, but you know, you've got a fancy Bexhill, as Saltbeam haven't started so well this term. They've already lost three games in a row. What are you thinking, Leon?
Yeah, just going by this season's record, you think Bexhill should go down there and get a result.
And then after that, they won't be playing again till the 29th of August. So that's the way the fixtures work out. That's Bexhill. Moving over to Little Common. Now, Little Common could only manage a draw despite taking the lead. That was against Loxwood FC. That was at the recreational ground. Sam Ellis put them in the lead, but it was another late goal. They've had a few in their games, it seems, that, you know, not holding on to leads. Any thoughts on that game, Leon?
You can only imagine maybe the conditions played a part in that game. Might not have been a pretty game to watch. Obviously, it's difficult if I'm not actually there, but just by going, what I've seen online, Loxwood picked up a few bookings. There wasn't much of a crowd there, really, which is quite disappointing. Only 84. Maybe if they prefer the day on the beach.
Yeah, maybe. Oh, it seemed too up for the beach, though, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But, right, so then Little Common's next game, it's going to be at the Wifteen Sports Complex, and that's against AFC, let me see if I can say it properly, Vardenians?
I said it.
They were going to be playing tonight, which is this Monday, but it's been moved. So that bit confusing. Sometimes these fixtures are all over the place. So that's Bexhill and Little Common. So let's move on to MSFL. I mean, as we predicted, it was a tough day at the office for Battletown, as a very strong Hollington side run over them. I mean, it was a first half hat trick from Paul Rogers, with additional goals from Brad Pritchard and Zach McInerney. Well, and then Paul Rogers finished it off. He got four in the end. Just a steamroller in there from Hollington. Any thoughts?
Yeah, well, welcome to the Mid-Sussex Prem for Battle.
Yeah.
I mean, you sort of look at the two lineups. Hollington's is full of players that have experienced that level and high. I mean, Paul Rogers, I think it was Sidley's top scorer last season. But looking at Battle's team, there's a lot of names in there I recognise who I've played against over the years at multiple, you know, various levels in the East Sussex League. They've all sort of had to make that step up, but don't know if anyone in that team really has that experience at that level. But I mean, it doesn't get much tougher for them than Hollington United, you know, probably one of the favourites to win the league. So, well, I was about to say it can only get easier, but they've got Ringmer next game. So, who knows?
Well, hopefully they can bounce back from that.
Yeah, I guess, or maybe the fixture secretary doesn't seem to like them.
Yeah, it could be. That's a conspiracy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, then after that, obviously, Hollington have got, they're entertaining Linfield. Leon, will it continue to rain goals at the Gibbons, do you think?
Well, it'd certainly be a tougher challenge for them, wouldn't it? I mean, Linfield finished fourth last season, so we don't know any ins and outs at Linfield, how their team's looking at the minute, but you just expect Hollington to pick up another 3 points.
Okay. And now we look at Westfield. Well, there was more goals. There was plenty of goals again. Westfield took on Willingdon and tore them to pieces at the Parish Field, running out 6-1 winners. So there was goals from Warren Pethig, Josh Pickering, Liam Ward, Callum Smith, and an own goal. I mean, well, that left the Westies faithful in ecstasy, I can imagine. So, any thoughts or on that game, Liam?
It just appeared to be raining goals Saturday.
Mm.
I think we expected Willingdon to be one of the stronger sides out there. So, surprised Westfield went out there and smashed them in the manner they did. Once again, next game, they've got Holland Sports, who finished fifth last season. And there was a bit of history between the two sides. Their former manager used to have a YouTube channel sort of following him about. And the first time he played him for his old team, Charlwood, there was a bit of needle to it, let's say. And then when he took over Holland Sports, that sort of carried on. There was a bit of banter from the Westfield lot who lost. So no doubt Westfield will be wanting to get a bit of revenge on Holland Sports.
Well, yeah, then we move on to Settlescombe. Settlescombe started off their campaign fantastically well. 2-0 up, second half against Balcombe. Goals from Dan Tyler and Ross Chambers, both from set pieces. And unfortunately, they let it slip, lost 3-2 just towards the end, which is a real shame. Well, Settlescombe entertain Ashurst Wood this Saturday. Let's hope that they can bounce back from that late defeat.
Right. Yeah, he's hoped so. Ashurst are one of the newly promoted teams. We don't know how they fare at this level, but Settlescombe will be looking at that as a good chance to get their first points of the season.
So that's our MSFL sides. Moving on to ESFL, obviously the big kickoff isn't until the 3rd of September, but they're still playing regular friendlies. Our co-host here, Leon, he was playing on Saturday in a very eventful game. I heard you were playing in goal, Leon. What's that about?
Yeah, I had a stint in goal. I was a bit sort of carrying a bit of an injury before, and so I wasn't sure if I was going to play. We were in need of a goalkeeper, so I said I'd go in goal. And then someone popped up and said I could play the first half. So ended up playing the first half out on pitch. Sort of thought, well, if my calf goes, I'll just come off. It's absolutely fine. Mm. Second half went in goal, but took my sort of fourth goal kick, and I could sort of feel my calf twinge a bit.
Oh, okay.
So it was a bit ironic doing all that running about. First half, absolutely nothing, and then standard batting goal, that's the second half, and that's what it
did. So you're playing Westfield thirds?
Yeah, that's it, yeah. So their fourths and Rye seconds played beforehand, and we played after. But I think Rye beat the fourths 2-1 beforehand, and Westfield fourths looked like a very young side, obviously just come up from youth football. Mm. But it's good to see. It's not just Westfield. You've got Hastings Athletic, of course, a young side has come up from like youth football.
Mm.
Pass and move, I think they're doing the same. And so Settlescombe have been doing it for a few years now. So it's good to have all these teams, you know, working on having like good youth set up and trying to, you know, fully integrate them into adult football. So long may it continue.
Yeah, I mean, it's very important. They need to be playing at this level now, don't they? And learning the physicality aspects of it.
Yeah, definitely.
Talking of physicality, I noticed on Twitter that there was someone visited a fracture clinic in your game. I mean, you weren't giving Hogan Bigfoots to people, were you? What's going on?
I don't know. Don't know what happened there. Just sort of saw the lads in a heap in the ground. And you know, when they got down injured, you know, they've probably hurt himself. Yeah. Sort of sent a quick tweet to Westfield asking how he was doing, and apparently he was in the visiting the fracture clinic today. So I've never got the lad's name, but I hope it's not nothing too serious, or he's not out of the game for too long with it. So yeah, speedy recovery to him.
Yeah, whoever it is, yep, my thoughts exactly.
Mm.
Yeah, we've got a final word. I know Leon, who's definitely been ref by this gentleman, I'm sure, might want to bring this up. It's the retirement of Alan Green. Take it away, Leon.
Yeah, so Alan announced his retirement from reffing. Well, reffing competitively. He might do the odd charity game here and there. So I saw him on Saturday. But yeah, he's been reffing a good number of years now. And he's personally, he's one of the names I'll see. He's reffing one of my games. And I think a good game here. But he's finally hung the whistle up. Well, enjoy your retirement, Al.
Yeah, he's probably got through all those bungs he took. He's got a place in Malibu. No.
All those trips to Vegas.
Yeah. 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 He's good mates with my neighbour, Matt the ref.
Oh yeah, yeah. Of course.
Matt Goldsmith, isn't he? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they're all schemed together, don't they? These refs.
Yeah.
The mafia, the ref mafia. Yeah. Best of luck with your retirement, Alan.
I don't know if you wanted to put this in, but another guy called Ken Brook. I think he's packed it in as well. I know the name. I might recognise the face, but yeah, it's another ref that's hung the whistle up. But it's a bit of a worry, though, isn't it?
I mean,
I was about to say, yeah, you got all these refs, you know, these long-standing refs that have been doing it for years, all hanging up the whistle, just probably getting a bit fed up with it, really, because we all know it's a thankless task. And there's not as many new refs coming in as are going out.
Is there not? I mean, you'd know about that more than me, mate. What I mean is that the case? I mean, is there?
Yeah, I'd imagine so. Because like now, what they do in the East Sussex League in particular, because of the shortage of refs, like say you've got like more than one team, like one team will play a game beforehand, and then the next team will play a game in it afterwards and use the same ref. Because yeah, I mean, I've had a couple of games last season where we've not been able to get a proper ref, and we've had to find a volunteer for it, and you know, they're not an actual ref. It just descends into just, yeah.
Well, yeah,
a bit of a farce, but
I've seen you play, mate. I know what you try and get away with. So
only when you're playing.
Wait, okay. Well, listen, thanks again, Leon. That was the week that was. So, I'll see you next week, sir.
Yeah, I'll see you next week.
Well, I'm a king, babe. Buzzing around your hive. Well, I'm a king bee, baby. Buzzing around your hive. Yeah, I can make honey, baby. Let me come inside. Well, I'm a king bee. Want you to be my queen. Well, I'm a king bee, baby. Want you to be my queen. Together we can make honey the world has never seen. Well, buzz a while.
Now over to my interview with John Carey, Hollington manager. It gives me great pleasure to have John Carey here, Hollington United boss. It's been a long time coming, this. Various scheduling reasons I couldn't get him on. Really looking forward to this interview. John, last season he did the double with Sidley, winning the Mid-Sussex Prem and the Sussex Cup. A great achievement on top of 5 years of almost constant promotion, wasn't it, John, up in the ESFL?
A lot of hard work went into it at the beginning. It took me 3 or 4 years to get the side I needed to put together to get where I wanted to be. When I first took over, I had a goal with Sidley to get him back in the county league. It was discussed when I took the job that that's where everyone wanted to go. we finally got to the position where we could go there. And I don't want to say slag them off too much, but they didn't want to do it in the end. And I thought to myself, do you know what? I've taken them as far as I can take them. It's time for me to move on.
In terms of that, though, John, was it just it was the financial implications, or was it just the structure wasn't there?
They keep saying that we didn't have a ground to go up. We didn't have this. We didn't have that. We did, because there was things in place. We could have gone to Eastbourne United and shared their ground. I'd already spoke to Anthony Story about that, and he was all up for it. I know it's not home being back in Sidley, but it's still County League football where they hadn't been before for like 10, 12 years. So there was stuff in place. I think it was financially they didn't want to do it. And obviously it's a lot more work for the committee, which is understandable. The committee's, no disrespect, and they're aging now. And if they didn't want to do it, they didn't want to do it. But at the beginning when I did take over, that it was all planned to do that.
Okay.
I didn't leave them in the lurch. I'd already told them halfway through the season, last season, that I was leaving because, you know, what they didn't want to do what I wanted to achieve. So they had enough time to put things in place. They just left everything to the last minute.
Okay. Well, there you go. John speaks his mind. So taking over, how did they sell Hollington to you?
To be honest, I'd already made the decision that I was going to have a year out. I had a couple of other offers, to be fair, apart from Hollington. But I know Scott and Ross quite well. They said to me, you know, come over and have an interview, just see what you think. I said, well, I've already told the wife I'm having a year out. So we wanted to do things together. We've got two young kids still. But I went over there. I had an interview. I think he interviewed four other people. And I told them if I was to come in, what I wanted to achieve. They told me where they wanted to go. And to be honest, it just ticked all the boxes for me to try and get them into the County League is what my goal is.
Yeah. Okay. You brought a few over from Sidley with you, and particularly, well, there's a gentleman by the name of Paul Rogers.
Yeah.
Did you think, I mean, it seems to have clicked immediately as he's just bagged four goals on Saturday. But were you slightly nervous that he might not be able to make that change over to Hollington, a sort of different squad?
No, I'm quite close to Paul, to be fair. I've got a lot of time for Paul. I've got a good relationship with him. As I have all my players, I think. You know, we're quite a close-knit bunch. The thing I was worried about was keeping the Hollington boys that I wanted to keep there and then merging. I didn't want there to be a divide. I've already lost one lad because he felt he was a bit out of place and, you know, he didn't think he'd fit in. But I think it's clicked quite well with the boys I've brought in. I'm hoping to bring two more in before the weekend.
Oh, okay.
And that'll be it, me done then, so.
Nice. Any clues or...
No, I'm not giving. I'm not giving no names away. But you'll see probably on Twitter by. One of them's coming train tonight. He's going to sign tonight, and hopefully he'll be with us Saturday for the game. So,
brilliant stuff. Yes, yeah, Hollington Twitter, very good, always informative. One of the better Twitters at this level because sometimes it's a real nightmare doing these the week to weeks trying to find information out, but your club's excellent with
I did have a discussion at the start. It needs to be run right, so we're getting there.
No, definitely. So in terms of the future of the club, you've come in, they've given you this vision that they want to do this, which fits your vision.
Yeah,
I mean, where can this club go? I mean, it's a great little club, Hollington. It's a nice crowd there, family club. I mean, where can you see yourself in, like, say, 3 years in terms of what could possibly happen, do you think?
In 3 years' time, I'd like to be in the County Prem, if I'm honest. This year, there's stuff going on behind the scenes with the ground, so we can go up. Our aim is to go up this year to County One. And then obviously put a side together in the next, once we go up, put a side together to get us into County Prem. That's where the club wants to go.
I mean, in terms of that also is a financial thing now. I mean, have you got the finances there to get yourself at that level?
There's stuff going on behind the background, obviously, with the floodlights. Obviously, they're on about putting a car park in up the ground, which is going on behind the scenes now. There's meetings with the local council. I try not to get myself involved in that side of things because obviously I've got too much to do with the team. But I know I've told them that I'll do my bit on the pitch, but make sure at the end of the season it's all in place so we can go up. And they've promised and reassured me it will be. So,
excellent times for Hollington. Obviously, ex-Hastings player Lee Carey at the club, coaching. I mean, what's it like? I'm sure it's your brother, isn't it?
Yeah, it's my younger brother.
So, what's that like having your younger brother knocking around in the coaching? I mean, do you bully him? I know.
No, I don't bully him. He's a godsend to me, really. I've got a quite close relationship. I speak to him every day. So, it's quite nice. It's quite nice that we can actually finally do something together. I'd love to still be playing, but my knees just won't let me. So, but no, he's great. He's great. He loves all the training side of it, which, you know, I let him crack on with it, which is good. So it gives me a chance to do other things that I need to do. But yeah, no, he's a good lad. I've got a few players that are still too good for that level, really. But that's the luxury that I have.
Yeah.
I'd like to get the local community back together and get bigger crowds down there to cheer the boys on, because it is a community club, as you say. It's a great little club. It's got a clubhouse. We do food all the time. There's drinks. You know, it does need local people to get behind us to push it where it needs to go.
Yeah.
And that's the same with any local club, not just us. Westfield need it. Settlescombe need it. Sidley need it. We all need local people and volunteers to help at local clubs.
Well, they're their lifeblood, aren't they, the volunteers?
You can't thank them enough. Every Saturday, there's people up there. I think the chairman goes up there at half eights and starts putting the goals up, you know. If people like that wondered about, clubs like this wouldn't run.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. So John, I mean, I already know because we did the prediction roundtable. I know you think's winning your league this year, as in you are.
I'd like to.
Yeah. Just quickly, I mean, your first game of the season, an absolute spanking 6-0 win. Could you give us any kind of post-match on that? I mean, obviously a fantastic first half.
Yeah, no, we started bright, to be honest. Bearing in mind the temperature was absolutely ridiculous. I think up to the first drink break, halfway through the first half, I think we was already 3-0 up. So, you know, Paul's Paul at the end of the day. You only need to give him half a chance and he put it in the back of the net. He's a great lad. But yeah, half time we went in 5-0. I said to the boys, you know, I could see it being double figures if we carried on the way we was going. I didn't want to concede a goal. I hate conceding goals. So it was nice for a clean sheet. Second half, we took our foot off the gas a little bit, which was understandable. I made 5 changes. But yeah, we didn't concede and we scored another. So, you know, promising times.
Oh, excellent stuff. Excellent stuff. John, thank you very much for your time. I look forward to speaking to you again throughout the season as your Hollington's the path to glory continues.
Hopefully. That's the aim.
That's the aim, yeah. And please take care. Love to have you on again. Thanks for your time.
That's it. Thanks very much.
New corner. by my soul, darling. Make me love you in the morning time, yeah. If ever I treated you bad, make it up to me one time. 'Cause I'm happy inside all the time. I want you beside me, yeah, to be mine. One thing you got to do is when I weep, holding hands together, you've got to know that we love and love each other, yeah. And if every time you should walk away from me, you'll know I need your sympathy, yeah. Can you see? Do you believe me? Oh, darling, darling, I'm calling, calling. Satisfy my soul. Satisfy my soul. Never, never, never give it up now. All in the same boat. Rocking on the same rum. We got to get together. You're in each other. And can't you see what I've got for you, yeah? I'm happy, 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 happy. And not even time to be blue. Come a little closer.
And now over to the SBTS fan roundtable, and many thanks to Smithy, Big Malk, and Windy John for making it happen.
Yeah, I don't know what Adam is. He's identifying as a bullock.
It's Perry from Birmingham.
Perry from Birmingham. All right.
From the Commonwealth Games.
Oh, very good. So one went to the Commonwealth Games, did he?
No, I just really like the idea of the teddy.
Oh, bless you, little sweetheart.
I'm still five.
Yeah, well, that's staying in. It gives me great pleasure to chair this fan round table. There's only a few of us here because we've had a few no-shows, but the show must go on. And what lovely individuals we've got in Windy John Gale and Adam Smith. He does the Twitter. He does the Supporters Club. He does everything. And also a late run-in from Malk. Yeah, who's decided to turn up.
He's as late as Stoney turns up to games sometimes.
Exactly. Like his son, turns up late.
I'm early. You said quarter two.
Oh, it's Christmas.
Did I? I don't know. I can't confirm or deny that. Well, let's get cracking into this. It's been a mixed bag of a week. Obviously, the defeat with Averley and a fantastic draw, turning it around it against Folkestone. But so let's just start on Averley. Were you there, first of all, Mal? Actually, I haven't even said it. And a wonderful, warm welcome to Malcolm, his agent extraordinaire. Still, I'm not sure if Leon's signed up with anything yet. I mean, what's the latest there, Malcolm?
I don't think he wants to know. His commitment's not there. So, but I won't let him go. You know, I'll keep trying for him. But, it's the best he's going to get, I think, 2 pints and having to pay a fiver to play.
Yeah, I mean, is he paying you any money? I mean, obviously you're representing him.
No, I don't take anything until he gets above. I can't divulge, he's not paying anything.
It's like the magic circle. It's just some things you can't know with agents, yeah?
Well, that's right. I saw him in a queue last night for the food, and I said, is it the right place for you to be? You'd catch your agent, or your agent catches you standing in a queue, for a burger.
There he is.
Ah, there I am.
There I am out.
Yes, what a beautiful man. Beautiful man. Right. Let's crack straight on. For firstly, let's talk about the Averley game. Now, before the Averley game, it's why especially I know that John's on here today, there was a minute's applause. Actually, John, do you want to talk about it, about your friends?
Yeah, it's for Graham Hannah, long-time friend. And yeah, to be fair, he hadn't been watching Hastings regularly until about 4 or 5 years ago. Well, basically, I expect some of you might know that he's the uncle of Hayley Agata. Yeah, Chris Agata's wife. So Andy Hannah, who was at the game on Saturday, is Chris Hayley's dad. So so there's a bit of that's when Graham started coming up there when Aggie took over. He had been up there before then a few times, but anyway, so yeah, and he was pretty keen, been to a few away games. But yeah, I've known him a long time. So since 1979, and poor lad, he just went downhill quite quickly in the end. And yeah, so hopefully he's at peace now. But the family, which was on the day, was his brother Andy, John, and Duffer, which is his... His real name's Dave, but they call him Duffer. There's another couple of other brothers, Neil and Malcolm, that were unable to attend. Couple of sisters. So they all want to say thank you to the club and to Pat and to the fans for the minutes of applause, which was brilliant. I mean, some of them probably didn't know what they're applauding because you couldn't hear it on the tannoy again, but we won't go down that lane. But he's a nice guy, Graham, and he was a bloody good footballer too. He's very quiet off the pitch. And put him on the pitch, he was a different player altogether. He was a beast. I remember him playing for Bexhill Athletic Football Club, and he was centre of defence, very good player. Probably could have gone on a bit further, but I'll have to tell you about that another time. There's a story behind it, which the family didn't want me to relay on here.
All right, fair enough then.
He was a lovely guy. Very well known and quite close to our family as well. He did a lot of decorating for us. He's a decorator by trade. Picked up a few jobs over in some of the schools, over Bexhill, St. Richard's, schools like that. Ultimately, that's where he caught COVID and it didn't help towards his cause probably because it was lungs that got him in the end. But here you go. He's a lovely guy. Couple of other little notes. Yeah, he played for Sidley as well, under 18s. He was well thought of. A lot of players from the Bexhill area knew him. I was quite surprised. I shouldn't have been really, but when I put some posting up on the Facebook site, there's lots of people commenting and a few people got hold of me personally. So anybody who wants to know, he's got his funerals on the 2nd of September at 2:15 Hastings Creme. Unfortunately on my way, but it's one of those things. But it's lovely guy. So there you go.
Thanks for that, John.
And as I say, that's the family wanted me to relay that. So thanks for letting us on for that one, Chris. Thanks.
Of course, no problem at all. So moving on to the game. It was kind of a slightly feisty affair at times, but a game I felt we should have got a result out of, but just last couple of minutes just switched off, you know. Lewis shouldn't have gone for it. The defender should have covered it, sort of, you know, and then they nicked it. Who wants to start on it? Malcolm, were you there, mate?
I was there, yeah.
Any thoughts on it, mate?
Well, pretty much, what you said, I think we should have got something out of it. But I think, it was one of them games. It was, the weather was red hot, wasn't it? Mm. You know, I don't think any of the boys have played in conditions that hot. It was hot enough in the stand, let alone out on the pitch. I don't know. I just think this year, if you make a mistake, you're going to get punished for it. Mm. And that's the next step, next level up that I think the boys are fine. You make a mistake and you will get found out and get punished for it. And that pretty much, you know, that's what it was. It was two mistakes and or two, I won't say mistakes, or I will. It's switching off is a mistake, isn't it? You know, so at the end of the day, that's what you do. You switch off and you get punished for it. I think it's going to be a very steep learning curve. Hopefully the boys will learn it. I think they will. I don't think Gaz and the staff are not let them learn it. Hopefully, you know, we do all right this year, but you know, perhaps that was the kind of game that they should have won, and they'll learn from it. You know, it's without jumping too far ahead, I think they did learn from it, you know, and it's last night proved it. So.
Yeah, is it John, any thoughts, mate?
That last goal, their winner. We saw that video clip. I suspect most people saw it. The video, I think one of their fans must have taken it from behind the goal. I think it was quite harsh blaming Louis. The sun's right in his eyes. Yeah, he should be wearing a cap, but when you're a goalie and you've got a cap on, it's not always that easy anyway, especially when the sun's at that position. And did that ball actually go out off? I mean, you kept hearing some people saying it came off the boarding and then went back in play, but none of the players moaned about it. So I don't think that happened. I don't know. You couldn't see on that video clip, but I reckon it must have come off one of their players, knocked it back, and then luckily for them, it just got banged in.
It's just one of those horrible... I mean, it was a great ball from their perspective. It was a horrible ball. And it's just... If just Louis would have stayed where he was... Instead of going for it, but it was always going away from him. And then obviously, I think it was it Finn?
Finn was behind him.
And it was just, if it had just, but it, as I say, it's, the heat was ridiculous. And you're going to have more moments where you're going to, as I say, switch off. You know, and obviously we got punished for it.
I thought we played better second half. Throughout the game. And I was really impressed with Bailey. On his first game, and I was a bit disappointed. He looks like he's picked up an injury, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Cruciate.
Is that serious or?
Yeah. Cruciate tear, I think, is what I heard.
Bloody hell.
So,
it's going to be a little while.
I thought Bailey looked very impressive out of the new ones for me, especially his second half. He seemed to push forward more, and some of his crosses were brilliant. And he's got some pace on him as well. I think Ben needs a bit more up front with him, though, doesn't he?
Could be. I mean, what do you reckon, Adam?
Yeah, I think going on that, it was nice to have pace at left back and right. And where we do so well, getting down the wings, we were getting crosses in.
Yeah.
We were lacking a second striker in the middle. So we need to find somehow to combine the both. But we created a lot, but it wasn't falling right. And with Averley, they sort of took their couple of chances. And it did look like their second goal, the ball went out. You don't really see one of their players in the video, but obviously it's an awful video.
He was probably holding the camera.
I was more interested in the reaction from Hastings players. No one sort of went running over to the ref and it. I don't think it went off.
It looked a bit confusing, didn't it? Yeah. It looked like Louis and Finn sort of couldn't really believe it. And if you're being fair to Louis, I think it's like almost he left it because he knew it was going out. But he might not have seen someone coming around the back. But
it's one of those things. But I mean, he pulled off a brilliant save himself about, 10 minutes before that?
Oh, yeah. And it's one of them, isn't it? It'll balance out in front of the season. It always does. We get lucky things and whatever. Yeah. So, like Matt was saying, that they're going to learn from it. And
it did get a bit feisty, though, didn't it?
he was
clever. That was a clever sending off, really, because he kind of kept Popey down and got him interested in a bit of a ruck to stop because it was going across. We were on the attack.
Yeah, we're on a break.
Stopped the counter attack, didn't it?
We didn't need Ben reacting, but you know.
Yeah.
The dark arts, eh?
Yeah, if he'd have done that half hour earlier, it would have been there. Would have been a good end to the game, but
I mean, what do the players think, Mark? What I mean, was there any little whispers from them? You know, I mean, I know they must have been disappointed, but and is it a case of when this lot come, when we go to Averley, we're going to turn them over?
Yeah, I think so. You know, they were gutted. You know, I can only really speak for Craig. I didn't speak to anyone afterwards. So I think the heat got to me a bit. 20 minutes into the game, I didn't feel too good.
Oh,
and as soon as the final whistle went, I went, which is extremely unusual for me.
Hmm.
But yeah, I spoke to Craig and yeah, he was gutted. You know, it's one of them games they feel they should win. And when you go up a league, you tend to look at these teams and that and think, you know, where are we going to possibly pick points up, you know, and I think Averley is one of them. You know, they sort of come up from a same sort of league as us, but a bit weaker, I think, that the players would consider. And yeah, they it was a game that they thought they should have won. And I think they will go away and turn them over, although it's on a they got a 3G pitch.
And oh, it's not, is it? Oh.
Yeah,
Averley. There's a lot
it's
of
a nice ground. Season. I quite like Averley's ground. It's a new one, you know, they built there, but it's relatively new. But yeah, it's 3G.
Yeah. Talking of 3G, what do we think about what happened to Ashford?
Interesting one, isn't it?
Hmm. What did happen? I missed that.
Well, they got the game postponed because according to the people that told me,
yeah,
so this could be all fake news. The pitch had been deemed not fit for purpose and they couldn't play.
Many John
they Mills. They haven't had it certified yet. You have to get certified.
Yeah. And I won't say it's not fit for purpose. It's just not certified, is it?
Yeah. So what Ashford are saying is that there isn't enough people around to do the certification, and they couldn't get it sorted. But there's a few things in their release they put out that, oh, it should have been done a week before, and that they sort of left it a bit last minute, to my mind. So I think there's something more than just it's not certified, because it is an awful pitch.
It's not fit for purpose, is it, that pitch?
God. No.
Right then, moving on. Moving on to a far better result in game.
Yeah.
Which was last night's game at Folkestone. A nice little away fixture. Unfortunately, it's on a Tuesday. I think it would have been a lot more people there if it had been on a Saturday. But that's just the way that is. It was about still 8-9.
Highest gate, wasn't it? Highest gate, though, wasn't it, I think?
Was it? Okay, yeah, about...
I was the artist, isn't that? Yeah. About 880.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there was a little bit of banter, there was a bit of singing. The football itself was, I mean, having Sammy Adams on the pitch for a start, you could see that he was running things. The Kane Penn on the left who come in, we looked really, really solid. As I was saying to the boys before we come on, Mount, had a lot of Folkestone fans get in contact with me saying about how organised we looked. And considering all the people we got out, that's actually quite a bloody good achievement. So, well done, the lads. And we could have nicked it.
Yeah. We were a better team last 20 minutes, weren't we?
How did Moynes play?
He grew into the game really well. He looked nervous, which was understandable.
He's from Hollington, isn't he? Is he from Hollington?
I think he played a season at Hollington.
Okay.
I think Hollington put out a tweet saying it was good to see him start, but I think that was a bit of banter there that, you know, made a few
Hollington and banter, eh?
Never. Surely not. Okay.
No, it was just a thoroughly enjoyable game. I just felt we really did, you know, we really did match them.
I followed it on Twitter and it sounded like we had a lot of the possession, fair few chances by sounds of it as well.
We
had a few as well.
Yeah, they had some, but you know, for us, I think, you know, after Saturday to create a few more chances, because it did seem a bit dry up, especially the first half. First half, we struggled a bit, but yeah. So no, that's, I was really pleased with that last night. And Folkestone aren't, you know, they're not going to be walkovers, are they?
No, they're going to be up there.
Yeah.
And old yeah. Alex, that he had a great game as well, didn't he? Alex Breffo. I thought he did anyway. Just
yeah. It shows.
It's a proper game of football last night.
Sorry, yeah. Malk?
It was a proper game of football last night. There was individual battles all over the pitch, weren't there? And it was a little bit niggly at times, you know. And it was proper football. And I know the boys loved it. You know, I know Craig was buzzing, you know, at 0-0. He said, but that's a proper game of football, you know, and they really enjoyed it.
I think the ref helped that as well. He let ones go that were just nothing tackles, but in other games it would have made it really stop start.
I thought he had a really good game.
Yeah, I did.
He made a couple of decisions sort of 20 minutes from the end that you thought, oh, well, I don't know, you know, like they were a bit silly. But the rest of the time, I thought he had a really good game. You know, at this level, it's quite unusual, but yeah, I've thoroughly enjoyed his game as much as the players, really.
And three good saves again by Louis as well, didn't he?
Yeah.
So, you know, like you said, you're going to win some, lose some. With Louis, he's you know, he always makes up for everything, doesn't he?
Yeah. I mean,
their keeper made some good saves as well, but with his feet, it's really odd. He didn't seem to want to touch anything with his hands. But, you know, he kept it out.
What's the news about Ollie Black? Is he sort of carrying an injury? I know he's on the subs bench last night, but just surprised he didn't play.
I think he's a little bit away from full fitness.
Okay, that's fair enough. Good. That was good. I think that's a good... At the end of the season, they look back and think, point against Folkestone, that's not a bad result away.
Well, yeah, it's just particularly after that 1-0.
Yeah.
That defeat we had against
the
2-1 one.
Yeah.
When you think of their front three, you know, like they must, you know, they're on a big budget down there for their front three. I mean, one of them was playing at Grimsby, wasn't he? You know, and he's they've got they got a front three. I think there's about four or five that are. That are not bad, and I think there's a few that are they're sort of just making up the numbers, and I think they're relying on their front three that they're paying big money to think that, you know, you score two, we'll score three.
None of these are on your books though, are they, Mark?
None of them yet. I've done a bit of the scouting last night to see if I can get them on my books, but
you've got to get rid of Leon first.
I know.
But make a bit of space.
Can't you send him to Turkey or somewhere like that?
He just enjoys his job too much. That's
the problem.
Right then. So, well, again, I didn't stay too long. Did you and the players stay a little while at Folkestone, Malk?
Yeah. Yeah, I saw you in the bar on the corner, didn't I? As I went in there, and then we went over to the other one because it was Craig's wife's birthday. So,
happy birthday!
She went over there. Yeah, so we went over there and had a couple over there and a chat. And players didn't stay too long. They don't on a Tuesday night, do they? And it's a bit of a travelling distance for them. So, but yeah, stayed a while and. Yeah, they were pleased, like I say, all buzzing, really. It's not a place you really want to go on a Tuesday night, but if you are, second game into the season is the time to go. You don't really want to be going to Folkestone on a Tuesday night in January. You know, they're...
The only time I've been there was end of the season, semi-final playoff when we lost, so that wasn't too good either. It's a nice little ground. No. I quite like the ground. There's something about it. I don't know. It's not. Yeah, it's all right. It's quite a friendly lot over there as well.
Yeah, not bad. Yeah, nice.
Yeah, and they were very. Like, there was a few of them that were saying that we came for a point and we're relegation.
Oh,
fodder.
Yeah.
And it was like, well, all right. Well, we drew against you. What's that say about you? But the. you know, there was a few quite appreciative fans there that were just like, you know, they enjoyed the fact that we brought a few along, and that was, as Mark said, it was a really competitive game of football. It was it was a good one to watch.
How many do you reckon from Hastings there then, roughly?
I reckon a couple of hundred.
That's bloody good, isn't it?
Yeah. All the normal faces were there, other than the only one that weren't there was Nick and Joe, Nick and George weren't there.
But the one that lives a stone's throw from the ground wasn't there.
George.
he can't be forgiven for that, can he?
Nope.
Right, and moving on to we've got Hornchurch next Saturday. I'll be honest with you, I don't know anything about Hornchurch. So who's going to fill us in? Is it going to be a tough fixture?
I don't know.
No, it will be tough. The way it is up there. They're an interesting bunch. I don't know whether they still do it. When they used to come down here, they never used to. They just come up right one end of the ground and stay there both halves. So, yeah, quite interesting. But they're, I think this side are going to be quite good. They got this guy called Liam Nash. He scored a couple of goals last night. I think he'd keep an eye on him.
It's only having him in his pocket.
Yeah, he's got him. Yeah. He's got him worked out. Thing is, you say, is it going to be a toughie, Chris? I don't think there's going to be any easy games. Mm. You know, and that's why I say I think the boys were looking at the beginning of the season saying, where can we pick up 3 points, you know? Mm. And, they thought Averley was going to be one of them, you know, and we didn't. So they're all tough games. A lot of them, Folkestone's, Margate, them type of teams have been in that league a long time. They know how to play it. You know, it's...
I did see Canvey Island won 5-1 last night. Danny Parrish scored twice, didn't he?
Yeah.
So,
he's happy now, is he, old Danny Parrish?
Probably will be. Don't know. You never know. Did players like
that? What was all that about, Malk? Did he just want to be number one, and that was it?
Who's that, Danny?
Yeah.
I don't know. I haven't got any information on that, I'm afraid.
You're no good. Yeah. You're no good a spy anymore, are you, Malk?
He's not his agent.
I quite like Danny as well, you know. I think if he had sort of hit peak form in pre-season and that, I think he would have gone on to be quite prolific, but it just didn't seem to happen for him, did it? And I think Gary probably thought, well, it's, you know, if it's not going to happen, am I wasting... you know, a wage on that, you know, as such, you know, so that's what happens in football, isn't it? You know, and there he goes somewhere like Canvey and you know, it be prolific perhaps. I don't know, you know, but it happens. And when we get Dawsey back, we won't even miss Danny.
Right. So please tell me, is Dawsey anywhere near
match He's done fitness? A couple of training sessions.
Hey.
We need him now, don't we? Really? We really need somebody else who can cause a bit of bother up front, as well as Benny. And Ben just seems to be on his own and, I don't know, he's crying out for somebody next to him, isn't he?
Yeah, we need to play two at times, I think.
Yeah.
I thought Ben did a lot of intelligent runs and flip-ons and things. No,
he's a clever player.
He doesn't stop running. No, he's one of those players, isn't he?
Yeah, there was a nice little bit of link-up play going on yesterday, I felt, with Ben. And was it Kane or was it... Who was the other fellow? Was it Kai Brown?
Yeah, Kai Brown.
I was quite impressed with Kai on Saturday, actually, when I saw him. That's the first time I've seen him. And I've I mean, he got the goal, which, right, he went in off the post, but he went in.
Don't matter, mate.
And he took it well.
Bloody goal, mate. That's all that matters.
And to be fair, he took it well, didn't he? I mean, it's... well worked goal. Yeah. I mean, I thought we might have nicked it after that went in, but it didn't quite happen, did it?
He's playing in that 10 role though, isn't he? And I'm not overly sure he knows how to do it as such, or, you know, whether it's his normal role. And I think when Ben runs the channels and he goes out there and he runs it, he's got the ball and he's got a fullback and a centre half that's followed him out there.
Yeah.
You know, and then he's looking up to for somebody to put a crossover, and there's no one in there.
No one in there.
And that's a problem that he's got. He's then got to try and take both of them on, and I don't think Ben's that type of player. You know, he's not got tricks and so forth, but he'll hold the ball up well. We'll bring other players into the game. You know, so when he finds himself out in the channels, which he did a couple of times last night, you know, and he's looking up thinking, well, what do I do with this? Right, okay, I'll hold on to it, try and take you on, and you know, but
yeah. How did Nori play last night?
He only got, 10 minutes at the end?
Yeah. Oh, did he? Yeah. Oh, okay.
And he come on for Ben. So he should have scored straight up front, which, yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah.
But yeah, I think Nori is better on the wing with the ball and everyone in front of him. So he looked a bit lost, but no, he did all right.
That's good. I just thought at the end of last season, he started to show quite a lot of signs of improvement. And I just hope it was going to roll on to this year as well. And I think it will as well. He'll get confidence. Yeah. He's one of those players who just needs confidence and it'll come.
Yeah, it's funny, Nori's mum keeps messaging, you know, he's playing. I'm watching, you know, like.
Yeah.
I'm watching my boy. So.
He'll be turning up on a motorbike in a minute.
God, you remember that?
I do.
That was funny. But anyway, trying to think. We've done that. What? Anything else we need to do? I can't think of anything else this week.
I've just got a quick message from Tim. If I want to read that out, you know, Timmy Reeves.
Yeah.
This is from Timmy Reeves. So back in the summer, he arranged a memorial race day for somebody called Barry Gurr. We knew as. Back in the day, he was one of Tim's best mates. Good player as well. It was held over at... that's all right, I haven't got the light on. Over at Linfield Park back on the May the 10th, I think it was. And Tim would like to thank all the sponsors, raffle donators and auctioneer prize donators and everyone who attended. And they raised, wait for this, 10,000.
Oh, brilliant.
And... Wow. £30, I think it says.
Excellent.
And that's all for St Michael's Hospice.
Well done, Tim.
So anybody who donated or anything, and well done, Tim, for organising it, because honestly, that guy amazes me. So, yeah, well done. Oh, yeah, thanks for that. He just wanted that read out. So.
That's all right.
Yeah.
Yep. It'll cost him 10 grand, that. Not really.
Yeah. Right. as well.
Well, just following on from that, Tim is going to do the Supporters Club a race night to raise some money.
Oh, okay.
So that's going to come in September. We're just working out dates at the moment. But, yeah, keep an eye out for that.
Yeah.
And also, we are running Player of the Month awards throughout this season. Anyone can vote on it during August. So anyone that watched the game last night, when we get back to the Pilot Fields, there'll be a little ballot box outside. So you can put your vote in for player of the match last night, and the winner will get awarded a trophy on the pitch.
That's cool.
Once the month's up.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So look out for that.
Or don't forget, they could do it on social media as well, can't they?
Yeah, and it will be on our website when it's up and live, which will that'll be done in a couple of days.
One other little thing.
Yeah, go on, Chris. Go on. No problem, John.
Very quickly, I just want to say the new bit on your podcast, with the local football.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm loving that, mate. I don't know whether anybody else is listening to it, but I'm loving it because it's...
I talk to myself normally. Go on.
I mean, I don't go on Twitter a lot anymore. I used to, but found it a bit too poisonous, to be honest. But
to find out
all the scores and everything now. And Leon, he must be, you know, glued to it to get all that info. So, yeah, great. And that little tribute to Big Al Green, referee. Lovely guy. I've got a little story about it. Have we got what's the time? Can I 5 minutes? Yeah.
Of course. Hang on. Anything to open the lid on the refereeing mafia that we all know is going on in Sussex.
The first time I met Al Green, he was reffing a supporters match down at Ball Drive. It's like the first team against the second team, if you like. And I think I was 47 at the time. So being on the second team, I was up against this guy called Leon. I don't know if anybody knows him, but anyway, he was a bit nippy. And the first attack
a bit windy
was
as well.
Yeah, no, you know, afterwards maybe, but I tried to keep up with him along the wing and he went into the penalty area and apparently, according to Al Green, there's a penalty. I acted him down, apparently, and I looked round and Al was in the other half still. So all I can assume is that Leon must have paid him extra donuts. If it was VAR, I'd have got sent off. No, no, that's the first time I met Al. He's a lovely guy. And, yeah, great referee. And he has done games at the Pilot Field quite a few times on the line, especially a couple of times. I think linesmen have been taken sick and he's gone in and helped out. So, yeah, good luck for his retirement, if you're listening, Al. And I know that he also does his spare time. He goes up Brands Hatch, which is a bit the old banger racing or whatever it is up there. And you've got to feel sorry for him because he's an Oldham fan. To be fair, yeah, I think he's an Oldham lad. But yeah, lovely guy. If you don't know him, think Phil Jupiter's with a referee's kit on.
Just thinking Oldham, when was the last time they were any good? It was probably the 80s, wasn't it? Oh, Andy God, Ritchie.
Yeah, back in those days, yeah. They were quite, yeah, they were a bit of a force, weren't they, for a bit?
Joe Royal was
yeah. And now where are they? They're out of the league now, aren't they?
They played Dorking the other day.
Jesus.
Cheers, mate.
Yep.
Yeah, it's good to be back.
Yeah. Lovely, and lovely to see you, Malcolm. It was a pleasure to catch up with you.
And you.
Yeah, oh, thank you.
And everyone else.
Thank you, darling.
Yep. Cheers, guys.
Yeah, take care, John.
See you soon, mate.
Miffy, take care, and Malk, and I won't see you at this game, but I will see you at a game.
Is anyone going to this game, Hornchurch?
I'll be there.
I'll be there. It's a lot closer for me, this one. Yeah.
Take care, lads, and see you next week.
See you later.
See you later.
That's it for another week, Grassroots Football fans. Isn't it great to be back? We've got tons of great clubs in this town. Get yourself to a game. As ever, if you want to get in contact with the show or have any suggestions or want to get in on our weekly roundtables, that email again is hufcpod@gmail.com or on the Twitter, which is @hufcpodcast. You can get this podcast on all major platforms, be it Google Podcasts, Audible, iTunes, Spotify, or Amazon Music. And we have a jam-packed YouTube channel, chock-a-block full of video interviews and episodes from the podcast. Please, please, please give it a look, a comment, or a like. But definitely subscribe. It's all free. All that's left for me to say is, I've been your host, Chris Laverick. Hope you have a good week, and see you at the game.